Thank you, Dr. Shanmugha Sundaram, and thank you, Dr. Satish, for a wonderful introduction. Hi, all. Good morning. Yeah, it's morning for me, and of course, it's evening for you all. So, good evening to you all. Hope you all can listen to me. Could you be able to hear my voice? Okay, I think so. So, yeah. So, why I am presenting this topic today is right now, COVID-19 is the hot selling cake around the world. You know, by this time, I think everyone should be aware about COVID and the side of those, not the infectious effects of the coronavirus and the symptoms. And now, putting all these regular things aside, like what you all know about COVID, let's do something different. Let's discuss some mechanism and about the drugs, about the vaccines, and about the alternative approach towards this COVID-19. And I hope you all are enjoying this lockdown, and me too. After the lockdown, just now I started coming to the lab, and these type of webinars are certainly one of the stress busters during this lockdown. So I think Dr. Shanmugha Sundaram, Dr. Satish are doing a good job in this. So without any further delay, let's go into the slides. Okay. So let me explain you about the epidemiology of the virus. And let me introduce, though you all know about this before, but still without an introduction about the virus, it's not good to go into the other slides, you know. So this coronavirus are a large family of single stranded RNA virus. They are different in different animal species, but the main source of this virus are from the bats. So these virus can cross species barriers. They can cause illness. And some of the common symptoms are cold, fever, and then finally, depending on the individual's immune system, it goes to more severe stage. This COVID-19 got the name because of the crown-like appearance, which is called coronum in the Latin term for the crown, and also because of the spikes outside the virus. So because of that, it got the name corona virus. And there are different types of coronavirus. Basically, it's alpha coronavirus, beta coronavirus, delta coronavirus, and gamma coronavirus. And this particular SARS-CoV-2 belongs to the beta COVID. And this is seems to be spreaded by the pangolins. And that's one story. And the other story is speculations are that SARS virus emerged from the man-made manipulation. But there is no evidence for that. And moreover, most importantly, the Chinese government has banned the research towards it, because the Chinese government doesn't want anyone to go and research, like whether it's from man-made or from the animals. So in that way, like, we got stuck in that research. But apart from that, there are research going on how this virus is infecting the cells, and what type of vaccines they can create to stop this virus. So here I'm explaining you about the death rate by age. So as you see here in the slide, as the age increases, the percentage of the death rate increases too. Why is it so? It's because as age increases, your immunity levels goes down. Especially your organs gets involved involution of the organs takes place, and they won't function properly. So, and your immune cells count goes down, and because of that, any type of pathogens, like, they enter easily and they create a severe infection in the old people. And especially with this COVID-19, there are the infections happening in the kids, especially below 18 and above 60. It's because I think the one main reason I would believe is because even the kids, the immune system of the kids are at the early stage where they cannot tolerate a sudden pump of the virus or any infectious pathogens. So they also tend to get infected. And coming to the other side, the old people, they have less immunity. So they get infected. So the in-between age people, they have a good immune system, and they already, probably due to the exposure of different type of pathogens, they tend to get their immunity developed, and all their memory cells are ready to fight against this virus or bacteria or any other pathogens if they are re-entering into the body. So the main thing is there is a 10% death rate with the heart disease people and people who have diabetes. It's all because they're all under stress conditions, and mostly due to the diabetes or in heart disease people, or in the when they have high blood pressure, all these type of things, their endothelium is really weak, you know. So this particular COVID virus, they tend to infect the endothelium very much. So due to that, lot of severe complications happens, and one of that is blood clots. This is the new one which is popping up. Research is going on in this, how blood clots are happening with respect to COVID-19. And also, one unknown infectious thing mechanism is the cytokine storm. So what really happens in the blood clot is due to the infection starts in the lungs, and the virus enters the body because of the breathing is the easiest way. And once it affects the lung cells, it begins to destroy them, and it travels into the bloodstream. And also, because of these type of attacks, the body launches an immune attack to fight against this virus. Due to too much of immune cells accumulating at that site, a lot of cytokine productions happens. And this, what to say, causing the cells to kill themselves because they couldn't able to withstand this cytokine storm, because in the infections, the infected cells release some chemokines and mediators. They attract a lot of neutrophils to a site, and on top of that, these neutrophils also have some antiviral functions. They also secrete more cytokines. So on top of that, too much of cytokines and too much of immune cells at the same site, the storm happens, and the cells try to kill themselves. And this storm happens, and finally it leads to death. So here I have mentioned some of the inhibitors and drugs, and also the mesenchymal stem cells are helpful in cleaning up this cytokine storm. And also immune boosting is really needed, where vitamin B3 is particularly good for the lungs. So that's why they are trying with all these different types of inhibitors and drugs and stem cell therapies and vitamin treatments to avoid this cytokine storm. Okay, so, and coming to the blood clot. So when the doctors try to see what happened after the this COVID attack, and when the people are dead, so they did the autopsy in the dead body. So they saw that most of the small blood vessels, there are a lot of clots. So this particular SARS-CoV-2 virus is creating clots in the blood vessels, and this is leading to the most of the complications. And moreover, now they are trying to see different type of approaches in the treatment, where they are giving some blood thinners and anticoagulants and all these things to try to see the patients whether they are recovering or not. So right now that's happening in the current scenario. But still a lot of research has to be done on this blood clot, how this blood clot is, because the regular symptoms like cold, fever, or difficulty in breathing, or nausea, or diarrhea, these, apart from this, so these were the things like till now they are facing. But all of a sudden these blood clots are the new one came up. So research are going on around the world to see how they can stop this permanently or without happening in the immune compromised patients. So here, these are the symptoms, how a new, this is another side of the COVID-19, where it's creating a kawasaki-like inflammatory disease in children, where it infects the children. On top of that, when a child is already, they're exposed to some other virus, on top of that, when this COVID attacks them, like too much of viral load, so they couldn't able to handle it. So they get this Kawasaki-like inflammatory disease, which have the symptoms of red eyes, high fever, red cracked lips and red tongue, rashes on the body, swollen hands and swollen feet. So if not treated in time, so this could be lethal for the kids. And only very, very few death happened in the children's, because as soon as they see the rashes and the fever, so they take the children to the hospital and they treat it at the early stage. So they're trying to save the children like that. And coming to the structure and the mechanism of the virus. So this is the structure of the virus. So these viruses are spherical particles with spike-like projections. Their average diameter is 120 nanometer, and the viral envelope contains a lipid bilayer membrane. So where they have, these are the spike proteins. So these spike proteins are the main things which go and attach to the host cell, and they create the cleavage with the help of some enzymes, and they try to enter the body and release the viral RNA copy into the body, and further they get multiplied, you know. So this inside the envelope, it has a nucleocapsid with multiple copies of single stranded RNA genome, where this spike proteins as well as the single stranded RNA genome are the main target for the pharmaceutical companies or the researchers target to stop this virus, or try to piece out the mechanism of the virus, and they are developing drugs and vaccines to stop this virus. And all that are based on this spike structural proteins and the single stranded RNA. So coming to the mechanism of entry. So once this virus get inside the body, so it goes to the host cell, where it has an angiotensin converting enzyme 2 receptor, where it, the spike protein here, so here it is. The spike protein here binds with this particular receptor, and it's trying to hold with the cell, and with this enzyme, the protease enzyme, so it comes and cleaves that particular place. When it's cleaved with the help of this enzyme, this virus enters into the body like this, and finally it releases the RNA, which I'll explain in the subsequent slides. So here you can see the mechanism of the entry. So as he said, like because of this ACE2 receptor and with the help of that protease enzyme, it cleaves the entry point and it enters inside and it releases the genomic RNA where it gets further translated into proteins. In the endoplasmic reticulum, it gets into that, and with the formation of the vesicles, then it the exocytosis happens and the virus goes out of that particular cell, and then again it go and start infecting this other cells by the same mechanism where it happened. And particularly in this mechanism, like you can see this where this virus viral RNA is getting translated, where most of the drugs target this particular area of this mechanism. So where the replication and the translation happens, and most of the drugs right now in the clinical trials, like remdesivir and some of the HIV drugs, and some other drugs also target this particular translation area. And as we know that initially, but not right now, but initially the researchers as well as the doctors were trying with the hydroxychloroquine, that all of a sudden it got attracted with the pharmaceutical companies. So, but that was a different pathway, because that actually targets the hydrochloroquine, chloroquine targets the endosomes, where it's a compartment where the virus uses as a different way of entry into the cells. So that chloroquine actually changes the pH of that particular lysosomes, so that the virus cannot replicate more. But there are definitely side effects of those drugs. So to a certain extent, they can use it, but not more than that. So coming to the drugs and vaccines. So here I'm going to explain you about the entry of the virus again, and also how it acts on the immune cells, and also to show that how the vaccine works. So the coronavirus enters the body, like as it binds to the ACE2 receptor and then gets inside, the virus RNA is released. Then it gets translated into proteins, and finally the virus, with the help of ER and the Golgi apparatus, it comes out. And then what happens exactly inside the cells, the virus actually gets ingested, or it have a crosstalk with the dendritic cells, where some of the specialized antigen, these dendritic cells are also called as antigen presenting cells. Some of these antigen presenting cells or the dendritic cells are specialized in engulfing this virus. And finally, these antigen presenting cells present that particular antigen of that virus to the T helper cells, which are the CD4 T cells. And once this antigen is recognized by the T helper cells with the major histocompatibility complex, 1 and 2 both. So that actually stimulates the B cells to produce antibodies against this virus. And also, these helper T cells stimulate the cytotoxic T cell, which plays a major, that the CD8 T cells, which are playing a major role in eradicating this virus. So what they do is they release certain destroying enzymes like granzymes and porphyrins and all these things, where they destroy the infected cells. And finally, what happens is at the later stage, so these all immune cells, the B cells and the T cells, they turn as a memory cells, will stay inside the body as the memory T cells or memory B cells. When they see this virus is re-entering the body again, like once a patient with this good immune system, and with good immunity, they recover, and they have these memory cells with them. So once the virus gets re-entered into the body again, so these cells recognize those virus again, they fight against it. So that's how it works. And let's see how the vaccines work. So normally vaccines are some of the, there are different type of vaccines like nucleic acid vaccines or viral vector vaccines and also virus vaccines. Often it's a weakened form of the disease. Some vaccines are injected and some of are inhaled. So they are injected into the body. So then the body thinks, because either it considers that the vaccine, whether it's a protein vaccine or a RNA vaccine, they consider it as an antigen and they try to develop antibodies against it. Basically, the vaccines boost the immune system. And because of that, the B cells and the T cells play a major role because those are the main immune cells when these vaccines are administered in the body. So, and once the disease attacks the body, these antibodies are ready to catch and destroy them. So, and this is how the vaccine works inside the body. So, and here I'm having a slide showing that these are the different types of drugs which are currently being used in the treatment of this COVID-19, where hydrochloroquine, which is the anti-malarial drug, which is a heme polymerase inhibitor, is being currently tested. And this ritonavir and lopinavir are the HIV drugs, which are being currently tested, which are a protease inhibitor, which plays a major role in inhibiting the translation process of this RNA, the virus RNA to the protein, and immunomodulator interferon alpha 2b, and mainly remdesivir. This is the current new drug which is on the run for the treatment of the virus. This remdesivir is a nucleotide analog where once the viral RNA started dividing and multiplying when translated into proteins, they have particular nucleotides in the RNA like A, adenosine, cytosine. I think you all are aware of those nucleotides, AGCT and instead of AGCU, instead of T, I think it's U in RNA, it's uracil. And I believe this remdesivir is analog for this adenosine nucleotide. So it's a nucleotide analog, and currently they're testing this. And favipiravir for the influenza virus has been tested. And also there are array of vaccines have been developed against this virus. So there are virus vaccines, which is there are inactivated viral vaccines and weakened viral vaccines, and there are viral vector vaccines which are replicating and non-replicating, and there are nucleic acid vaccines, either DNA or RNA, and there are protein vaccines and also some virus-like particles vaccines, and which has been tested all around the world. And these are the number of vaccines in the development. Mainly the protein-based vaccines are, they're targeting it maximum. So, and let's go into the details now. And as I told you, like this is the mechanism of the virus entering the body, and the replication happens, and then not really, then it goes to the translation stage where it converts into protein, and then finally with the help of the translation mechanism, it goes out of the body. It's a new virus and gets out of the body. So these are the different drugs used in that particular stage of those mechanisms, like where I see that chemostat mesylate is the TMPRSS2 inhibitor, where they're currently, once like they try to inhibit this particular protease enzyme, so that cleavage of that particular binding site won't happen, so that the virus won't enter into the body. So that's what is going on now. And hydroxychloroquine, as I mentioned, it inhibits the endocytosis mechanism. And this HIV drugs inhibits the translation mechanism, and remdesivir. Where remdesivir, during this replication transcription process, like they try to go and bind instead of A, like they go and replace the adenosine part, and they go and bind there, and finally, since there is an false addition of the nucleotide, this transcription and translation won't happen. So that it stops there. So this is the mechanism of this remdesivir. And moreover, remdesivir is a prodrug, which is also inactive form. And once that's injected and once it goes inside the cells, it gets converted into an active molecule, which is called as GS441524. And that particular active molecule is matching the analog of the adenosine. So that this particular GS441524 goes and binds to the nucleotide sequence. Instead of A, it goes and binds in that position. So this is the main mechanism of the remdesivir, and this slide explains about the mechanism of that and the hydroxychloroquine. And coming to the vaccines, so as I mentioned, like there are various different types of vaccines, and one among that is a virus vaccines. And at present, 7 teams are working on it and developing this vaccine using the virus itself, either in a weakened form or an inactivated form. So basically, a virus is conventionally weakened for vaccine, and passing it to the animal or human cells, it until it picks up the mutation and then make it less able to cause disease. And by weakening it, by altering the genetic code of the viral proteins, makes it less efficient. It won't create side effect, much of the side effect, or it won't create any further, any other type of disease inside the body. And inactivated virus, the virus is inactivated by formaldehyde or heat inactivating, so that it makes them less function, not functioning. So making them, however, request starting, they act as the antigen. For these antigen presenting cells, because when the vaccine is injected, so either in any form, whether it's a protein or a nucleotide or a nucleic acid or an inactivated virus, whatever goes inside, that is considered as an antigen for these antigen presenting cells, and further they start initiating the immune response in the body. And viral vector vaccines, around 25 groups are working on these vaccines right now. They are genetically engineered and it can produce coronavirus proteins in the body. These viruses are weakened so that they cannot cause disease. But still they can replicate within the cells, but they cannot cause any key genes which cause the disease. So these viral vaccines tend to be safe. They provoke strong immune response, and also the non-replicating viral vector vaccines also been used as an immune booster. So a US-based company, Johnson & Johnson, is working in this approach. Coming to the nucleic acid vaccines, there are two types of nucleic acids. One is the DNA vaccine and one is an RNA vaccine. So DNA vaccines are also based on the particular coronavirus gene, and RNA virus, of course. RNA vaccine also made from this virus. So these both, once they are injected or through the body, so they also start the same mechanism through how they the real virus genes do. So they started making an mRNA from the DNA, or they the RNA has been converted into a protein, and finally it's been recognized by the antigen presenting cells, and then it initiates the immune response. Protein based vaccines. So almost 28 teams are now this is the highest, I think, number of teams are working on this, because this is more easy for them to make the spike protein of the particular part of the receptor binding domain in that spike protein. So that's why they are trying to create these vaccines now. And particularly recently, a monkey model has shown some good improvement in the disease after this protein-based vaccines have been tested on it. So that also acts as the same mechanism where it initiates the immune response. And also a virus-like particle vaccines where they use empty virus shells, but it mimics the corona structure, but they're not infectious at all. So they lack the genetic material actually. So it's only the outer shell. Now only few teams have been working on this. So because this particular thing is not that effective. So that's why most of the people are going towards the protein-based vaccines. So, and some of the vaccines are in the forefront, which are going in the clinical trials. More than 90 vaccines are being developed against this COVID-2 by research teams and companies and universities. They are trialing in different technologies, and at least 6 groups have already begun injecting formulations into volunteers in safety trials. Most all the other vaccines have been started in the animal trials and testing in the animals. Yeah, and some of these vaccines, adenovirus type 5 vector vaccines has been conducted in the clinical trials by this CanSino biological company, and the DNA vaccines have been tested by Inovio Pharmaceuticals. There's a clinical all phase 1, phase 2 trials, and inactivated virus vaccines has been tested by Beijing Institute. It's also going on the clinical trial, and also inactivated Sinovac, and is also testing with inactivated vaccines. And the nucleic acid vaccine has been tested by Moderna Pharmaceuticals. Right now the clinical trials are going on, and it might take maybe several months or maybe years to get a proper data. And till that, we have to take care of ourselves by maintaining good health practice. So till now, I discussed about the drugs and vaccines and which are being tested, and some of the drugs have been already tested in other virus, and some of the new drugs have been popped up, and some of the vaccines are like how I mentioned now, they are also getting tested in this scenario. But on top of all these things, they have, because either let it be a synthetic drug or let it be a vaccine, they all have pros and cons, right? So actually there are a lot of side effects for these vaccines and also these drugs. So considering those things in mind, obviously, vaccines and drugs are the primary line of defense, but considering the side effects, we have to could you people listen to me? People hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes, sir.
Okay. Sure. Thank you. So, but still, we have to see some alternative sources also, considering the side effects of these vaccines and drugs. But on top of that, a new thing is happening which really caught my attention is now researchers from Belgium, they are trying to develop an antibody from llama, which is a camelid, which is an animal similar to camels, but they are found in South America as well as now they are in Belgium too. So they are using the antibodies, because naturally these llamas have these antibodies, two types of antibodies, like short one and the normal antibody. So we have only one type of antibody. Humans, we have only one type. And but these llamas have two types of antibodies. The second type is very short, but still they have the Y chain, which is the main for this fighting against the virus. And this llamas, especially the short antibodies from these llamas, are very much effective, and they completely eradicate this virus. So right from beginning, like from SARS and MERS, so these llamas played a major role in studying the how this potential against this virus. So now, because they have this natural tendency to clear off the virus, now the researchers are trying to get this antibody and try to genetically engineer this and try to develop a vaccine with this antibodies. So I believe that these particular antibodies getting from llama will be more safer, and it's going to be more useful than the other vaccines which are getting tested now. So this is something interesting going on, and let's wait for the result and the data. So now, since I already mentioned about the side effects and the the pros and cons of the vaccines as well as the synthetic drugs, right now what they're using. So let's see how the prevention is going to help us. So when we don't rely on the vaccines or drugs, because those are like once you get the virus or once you get the disease, like we go and get the vaccinations or we take the medications, you know. But how come the prevention is going to help the virus getting inside the body? So, and now I'm very much interested in the traditional medicines. Though a lot of our drugs used in the medical field are from the natural herbs or medicinal plants, but only few are scientifically proved. What is the reason, and why we are not giving much importance to this traditional medicines than how we are giving importance to the vaccines as well as the synthetic drugs? So because synthetic drugs are chemically made, and some people can react negatively to it. So, and long-term administration of these drugs or vaccines will give a serious side effects. So that's why I thought, okay, there must be some alternative options. So either we can get a particular single drug, I mean, not the complete extract from the plants, I meant either a phytochemical, either it can be alkaloid or it can be a flavonoid or something or anything. So which can be used as a drug for treating this virus. So why can't it happen? So traditional medicines are always, you know, not always, I would say, like most of the time, they're underestimated, you know. So most of the governments, they don't approve it as they how they're doing for the modern drugs. So this is one reason. I think it's because of the pressure created by the corporate companies or the pharmaceutical companies. They're putting pressure on the government because they are the main source of the economy. And also they don't want this natural medicines to come up, because once like they're easily available to the people, so their business will be down. So I think that is one of the main reason. And that's what happened in Madagascar also, I believe, because in Madagascar, like they found a COVID tonic, which was made with a group of herbs. But it seems like it's really working, but the World Health Organization is not giving permission or it's trying to stop it. But after a huge fight from the Madagascar president, and now the WHO agreed, World Health Organization has agreed to do the clinical trials on that particular tonic. So I can say that these Indian traditional medicines with inhibitory properties should be tested by the researchers, and the government should really support it, and that should be converted into the therapeutic drugs, and finally, like, we can test it clinically how it works on the patients. And suppose if it really works, then we don't need to worry about the vaccines or synthetic drugs and their side effects, because these natural based medicines are less toxic to our normal cells, and also it's not going to be, though of course it also have some side effects, because that will be all tested ahead before it comes to the clinical trials, you know. So I think that is one of the important thing we have to consider, especially the young researchers who are listening to this talk. I would suggest them to really take up this research and carry out this. And to be honest, they don't need to get afraid of this virus. So whether they have to handle the live virus, no need. They can even get the proteins from the virus, and also they can check with the knockout models of the mice of these receptors, and they can try with the synthetic peptides mimicking the proteins of this virus. And they can check with these natural products or the particular phytochemical how it is inhibiting this virus. And there are a lot of techniques also, like where they can use it, like molecular docking, like how this phytochemical is binding to the particular protein with the structure. So they can use that, and they can start getting into this research. And mainly why I'm suggesting this natural medicinal research is because this is going to be our future. And as we all are seeing, like right now we have started the old traditional method to prevent this virus, because always, you know, prevention is better than cure. So like I said, scientific validation and documentation is really, really must, because when you get older and older, these vaccines and drugs are not going to be helpful, because of this viral latency and the recurrent infection. Because once you get old, your immunity gets down, and our body is not going to support drugs when you're getting old. And in that point of time, when you start trying to get slowly into this natural way of treating, they are less toxic, and they are the very good immune boosters also, where you will have the ability to fight against these viruses. So this is what I was mentioning about the COVID tonic, which has been created by Madagascar. So here in this picture is showing that Madagascar president, Mr. Andre, is trying that tonic. And they are strongly stating that it is working against this COVID. So, but who was not giving the permission for this COVID organic, but after a big fight, he finally got the permission to test with the clinical trials. So hope this also comes out good. Not only in Madagascar, even in China, like the Chinese government, I'll come to that slide first here. The Chinese government is encouraging the herbal remedies to treat COVID-19. But scientists, obviously, they're warning against it because of the side effects. Obviously, side effects are there. That's why we are going to test the toxicity levels and how they are working. But the hardcore message is definitely these medicines derived from this herbal medicines or natural medicines are far, far better than the synthetic medicines. So right now, the Chinese government is really, really encouraging them to start doing research on that. And this one slide shows I think in 2009, they have published this paper where some of the medicinal plants, they have antiviral activities, and some of the plants have been mentioned here, and they are showing that it is having activity against different viruses, like herpes virus and mouse coronavirus too. It's a surrogate of human SARS virus, and also against the influenza virus. So, considering all this, I think our researchers should really, really concentrate in getting out medicines from these natural sources. And this one article is from China. Like, they have inhibited the coronavirus replications in vitro using the traditional medicinal herbs. Obviously, they are mentioning, I don't know the exact name of this, because they have given them botanical name. And obviously, looking into the rhizome, for me, the rhizomes means definitely they are for example, ginger, turmeric, they also belong to rhizomes. So we are also using ginger and turmeric in our daily food. So, and also most of the other herbs and spices also helps in boosting our immunity. So, and this slide shows the article based on the antiviral and immunostimulant activities of Andrographis paniculata, which is the, in Tamil, the nilavembu. It's called as nilavembu. And right now, the more attention is towards nilavembu and vepalai, obviously the neem leaves. These all have very good antiviral activities. And also, now I think our Tamil Nadu government is recommending this Kapasura Kudineer, where this Andrographis paniculata is one of the important ingredients in it. So, concluding it, so it might take months or years to find a cure. But till that time, we have to be safe. We have to follow some of these safety precautionary methods to prevent us from the coronavirus transmission. Like you all already know, washing the hands and cover your cough and avoid crowds and avoid unnecessary travel and wear masks, isolate yourself if you're sick. And on top of that, have some natural herbs and spices, like how we used to have in our food, and we can prepare kashayam and drink, and they are definitely a huge immune boosters. So it can prevent us from getting infected. So this is how it works in this scenario. And from this, I would like to conclude. I hope this presentation was really useful for you all. And I'm showing you the aerial view of my university and where I belong to this building, which is the Biomedical Research Building. And this is the whole Case Western campus, and this side is the engineering and campus, and this is the medical campus. And I would like to acknowledge everyone, especially Dr. Shannu Sundaram and Dr. Satish for organizing this webinar, and also some of the resources which were really helpful for me to prepare these presentations. Literatures helped me in understanding how these vaccinations are developed and how this really works. And thank you so much for the webinar presentation. And you're welcome to contact me by email. My email ID is